Hey, what's up, everybody, and welcome back to another issue of Hops Geek News. We are a podcast that gets together weekly and discusses comic books, movies, TV shows, and every once in a while, we talk about beer as well. This episode is our Shark Week episode. So if you know, we love the sharks here. We love marine animals, and Shark Week is a very fun time, big time. Last year, we had Thunder Levin, the writer for Sharknado 1. Well, this year, we're going to be talking about the 1975 classic Jaws. So if you don't want to listen to us, go ahead. You can skip to the timestamp in the thing where we talk about Jaws. But if you have never listened to us before, we usually start off with what we're drinking on this episode. We talk about things that we have messed up and also looked into from previous week. We talk about the latest in pop culture news. And we also talk about what we have been reading or watching lately. So with that said, I am Matt. With me is Lauren. You can find all of our podcasting episodes by searching Hops News on any platform. You can follow the link in our bio on our Twitter, which is Hops Geek News. Same with our Instagram, Hops Geek News, TikTok. You guessed it, Hops Geek News, excuse me.
It's and a tongue twister also, for us.
You can go ahead and go to hopsnews.beer. That is also our website where we write a lot of great content. Lauren has a lot of great things, such as her new Epcot Food and Wine Festival, where to find beers and things like that. There's, I believe, 36 different beers and things.
Different festival beers.
Yes, I'll let her talk about that in just a second. Go ahead, go to dorksideoftheforce.com where you can also find my articles where I've been writing for Star Wars and things like that. All of that aside, Lauren, what is it that you are drinking today? And please tell us about your article on Epcot's Food and Wine Festival.
So I am actually still finishing up the beer that I was drinking on Hops News because I am pacing myself. But it's actually a little bit shark themed, so I'm going to go ahead and tell you again. It's called a Mahi Did It. It's a play on words because it's got a mahi fish on it, which is also sometimes called a dolphin. And it's a triple IPA with Simcoe Cryo, Citra, and Citro Cryo hops. It is absolutely fantastic. Tripping Animals always makes amazing beers. And I'm trying to see the ABV on here. It's probably like 10%. I feel like all their triples are like 10%. I don't know. Maybe I can't see it because I'm almost finished with it. But I will have another one before we start Jaws that is on theme. And that's what I'm drinking. Epcot has festivals all year. Food and wine used to mean it's kind of bittersweet. Like it used to mean the beginning of fall. It would literally start the week in fall started, and it was like, this is, you know, the pumpkin spice comes out and then Food and Wine starts and then it's Halloween. And then, you know, before you know it, it's Christmas. Well, since COVID, they start the festival in the middle of July now, and they still have some fall themed beers as well. So I had a maple beer, which was really good when it was cold. And then because it was 100 degrees outside, it warmed up and it didn't have the same effect. It almost seemed like it needed to be in a teacup and a little bit hotter then. But it was delicious. So there are 36 festival beers. If you go to our YouTube channel or go to our website, I have a list of all the beers on the website, and I have an actual video showing you all the beers on our YouTube, and you get to see some of the decor as well. And every festival, I do one of these videos. After Food and Wine, it's Christmas. After Christmas, it's Arts Festival. After Arts Festival, it's Flower and Garden, and then back to Food and Wine. So it's very rare that there's not a festival going on anymore.
That's cool. I mean, you get to go to a mall. That's awesome. I love it. I love seeing all the different videos and things that you have. And Lauren absolutely crushes it. I don't give her enough credit. I try to, but she kills it, especially in the Disney regard. So please make sure you go ahead, find those, share those, like those, hey, maybe you have a trip coming up. Take a look at that. So
yeah. And if you ever have questions, let me know. I'm always happy to answer, especially beer related questions. I want people to want to know. I'm not just doing it for my own ego, I guess.
But yeah, I mean, how many times there's people like us who are like, hey, where do I find this at this place? Or where do I go for this? And Epcot, yeah, it's easy just to be like drink around the world, but it's also easy to get overwhelmed and lost at these things. So,
well, and if you don't know any better, like there's been times where I've been like, well, I guess I'm going to have to settle for this beer. And if I had waited 5 minutes, I would have found this beer. So that's kind of like
right. What
I try to do. Universal is a little bit harder because they switch out things so often. So it's like, you know, you can go there one day and they have, you know, the Neon Rainbows beer, which is a fantastic IPA from Omegang. And then the next time you go, they don't. And it's just, okay, the keg tapped or we ran out of cans. So it's a lot harder to keep track of there, other than like you always can get the Duff beer. You can always get the Dragon Stout and Diagon Alley kind of stuff. But Disney, they do a pretty good job of maintaining consistency, I suppose. I was bummed that Parrish Brewing Ghost in the Machine is not back.
Oh, no way. That's always a staple there. That sucks.
No, it was just there for Flower and Garden, but it was at Flower and Garden like the last 3 years.
Got you. Well, what I'm drinking, I actually decided to crack a beer open.
Woohoo.
So we'll talk about our Nashville trip in a minute, but I did. So I'm drinking, Do You Remember Your Last Good Hair Day? It is a dessert Berliner Weiss style ale with lemon, marshmallow, vanilla, and milk sugar. 7.5%. Coming at you from Hoofhearted Brewing out of North Haven, Connecticut. And I don't know, this just had like a snake and it looks like Murray on the front. So
it looks like Tiger King Stranger too. Things.
I'll post a picture of the can. So that's why I picked this one. It's really good. It's really light. I couldn't do an IPA or something like that after our trip to Nashville, which we talked about on our live show. But yeah, we went and we drank a lot of beers. We went to over 10 breweries. We brewed a really good beer with our friends at Common Law Brewing. We drank a lot of beers again. Lauren had her first drunk Waffle House experience, which I'm so proud of you, by the way. I'm just going to keep saying it. I'm so proud of you. Yes, those poor workers. I hope if you're in Spring Hill, Tennessee, for whatever reason, you go to that Waffle House. There's two people. Their server quit or like called out or whatever it was. They were stressed. The lady was like, my legs are jello. This man was like, I'm a cook, not a server. They crushed it. They did such a killer job. And I got waffles and hash browns. Lauren got her hash browns and she dumped them all over, the bed.
I literally just flipped them right upside down. I don't know what the fuck. I was like so excited to get my jammies on and get into bed with these hash browns. Flip right under the bed.
And they went everywhere.
My husband's like, it was probably for the best. She put a lot of oil on them. You shouldn't have eaten them.
Oh yeah. They were not hell. I woke up like I fell asleep mid waffle and like woke up in the middle of the night with heartburn and like a 45-year-old man and waffle. Oh yeah. But hey, we had Waffle House. I got Dunkin' Donuts. It cured my first day hangover. We had a good time.
Second
we got to hang
day,
out.
There was no cure. It needed days.
Second day, there was no cure.
He's still hungover. He's still hungover from Saturday night.
Got home. We got back at our hotel Saturday night at 2 a.m. We were in Nashville and we went out to like Music 2:30. Row. A lot of places. Yeah, it was actually probably almost 3. We caught a plane. I had 14 hours of traveling through an airport.
That's insanity.
So I couldn't quite sleep everything off. And so I slept the next day, half the day. And I just feel like crap the whole week so far. So I'm too old to be doing this. I'm not in my I'm not in my prime anymore. Okay.
None of my clothes fit. I like, I didn't even eat that bad. I just drank so much. Like I put on the
shorts. That's what it was. I barely ate.
The shorts that were Sunday. I had to like unbutton the top and then I put them on today and they fit again.
It was like all bloated. I felt so bloated from all the beer and oh God, I'm just like, what have you done, man? Look at you. And I just feel like when I worked out, I played basketball Tuesday. I just feel like I was oozing beer still and barley and stuff. I just felt disgusting when I was playing basketball. I'm so sorry. And I also felt so bad. Like on the plane, I just, you know, obviously sit next to somebody. I just like, I probably reek of hangover because Carrie, I saw Carrie and I kissed her and she was like, you smell like you're detoxing. And I was like, yeah, that's because I am. This is like 2 days later.
You smell like you're detoxing. Well, so I've done many a beercation at this point and other than my Alchemist experience, usually I follow my rules. I do good. Don't eat too light, you know, eat healthy, but eat, exercise in the morning and don't stay out late. I did none of those things.
We broke all those rules.
I broke every single rule.
I'm sorry. We definitely like, well, for once, cause this is only the second time we got to meet back up. So I feel like that played a factor. And then it was just like that scene in The Grinch where he's getting fed all the food. He's like, is that all you got?
That was all the beer.
That's literally what it felt like. Oh, yeah. All the beers being shoved in our faces. It was like, is that all you got? And then come Sunday flying home, I was like, please, sir, no more.
Well, my husband and I, like, well, not my husband. He made good choices. I went hard the day before, too. So, like, he woke me up Friday, and he's like, hey, we have to check out of the hotel at 11. If you want to go running, like, let's go run so you have time to come back. And I was like, no. And he's like, I'm so glad we both brought our running shoes on this trip that we did not use at all.
this isn't happening. No way.
I'm like, we have to run because, you know, I just started half marathon training for January and I have to follow my schedule. There was no schedules followed. It was a shit show.
That's okay. You know what? It was fun. No regrets. That's our credo.
Yep. And that's what our tattoos say that we got this weekend.
That's exactly. We got matching tattoos. Believe it or not, we did. And Music Row, we got no regrets.
And I got the Hops Geek News hopper on my ass.
That's true. It's all true. All of it.
It was the best
actually,
of times.
I
it was
have
the worst
thinking
of times.
About getting that tattoo, but that's neither here nor there. Speaking of things that we have messed up on in regards to our poor life choices, I just want to shout out real quick to Zach. He does all the other podcasts. We had him on as a guest and he actually went ahead and gave us his thoughts on last week's Stranger Things, Thor, and The Boys. And I totally forgot to mention it. So shout out to Zach. He went ahead, gave us his thoughts, things that he liked, he didn't like. So this is for you. I messed up. That was on me. My bad. Oh, Stranger Things season 4. He said that him and his wife really enjoyed the season. It wasn't a simple rinse and repeat of past seasons. There's definitely similar themes at times and they kept their attention. His only gripe is that Max should have stayed dead. And don't be like Star Wars Rise of Skywalker. Let the sacrifice mean something. And he's pretty sure that Will has powers, kind of like Eleven and Vecna, or maybe he's sensitive to the upside down to his time being there. He actually didn't see Thor Love and Thunder yet. However, with The Boys, he really liked the season. There was really great character development in times where we felt nervous for certain characters.
Are you gonna have a spoiler
and
for a
there were
second?
Some big players.
Any spoilers yes. or just opinions?
No, just opinions. Okay. He said he can't wait to see where they go. He liked Maeve's character. He's glad that she's still alive. And he really liked Jensen Ackles' Soldier Boy. And
who didn't?
Yeah, that was Zach's thoughts. Again, you can find him by looking up Neat Cast Pod, FN Culture, and Casters Assemble. Shout out to you, man. That's my bad. I'm terrible. I just the worst. Anyways.
So it's funny. My friend Ian, who he was on our Supernatural episode, he kept starting The Boys and wasn't falling for it. And finally he's like, okay, I'm pushing through. I'm on season 2. And he goes, I've never watched a show where I've enjoyed the plot so much, but I hate every single character. He's like, there's no redeeming That's qualities with any of the characters. True. And he goes, and I'm on the edge of my seat because I never know if somebody's head's going to explode or something. And my response was, I'm like, well, when you get to season 3, you know, you'll like at least one character because he's obviously a big Supernatural fan. But yeah, before we go into news, what have you read or watched?
Oh man, what was I reading? What was I watching?
Something we didn't get to discuss.
Well, oh, what?
Miss Marvel.
Yes. So we got to watch Miss Marvel.
The finale.
And we didn't get to watch. It was out everywhere in Disney Plus. And it was great. We'll go down saying that this was probably my favorite Disney Plus Marvel series to date. There was a lot of things I loved, a lot of things I loved in this. The culture, the way that they explored that family. And right off the bat in this finale, they got to the way her parents came together. It was funny. She was like, I am, you know, the light girl. They're like, who, what, what? And she's like, I am Nightlight. And then, you know, Abu and her brother were like, oh, what? No way. That's
crazy.
I was
like, in Friends, this is brand new information. He's like, you already know.
It was great. And so that was amazing. And I liked how there was no real drama. Like any drama that they could have had was solved immediately. So you didn't have that drag out. Like, oh, like the most drama was her friend basically being like, I can't believe you didn't tell me, but they wrapped
that
up pretty quickly.
Storyline so much.
Exactly. And it was great. You know, they ended up at the high school, all the friends, family, they're all helping. And the really cool thing was how all of her neighborhood and stuff came together to protect her and them from the Department of Damage Control. And that was really cool.
Right. Especially noticing like she's a child. And I think a lot of times, like we forget that with certain people, it's like, yeah, like high schoolers, like these are children. They are still forming, you know, their intellect and forming their opinions and forming their personality. They are children who are naive and need to be protected. And I think in the superhero exactly. stuff and in real life, you know, we forget that. Like Peter Parker too, he's a baby.
Well, that's the other thing is for the people who were basically like, oh, Miss Marvel's not for me. it's too childish, this, that, or the other. It's about a teenager, blah, blah, blah. It's like, okay, you realize Spider-Man is a teenager.
I know, that didn't make any sense.
He hides his identity. He's a superhero. This is literally also Ms. Marvel. Come on, man. Grow up a little bit. It was great. Had a lot of heart.
Yeah.
But we're burying the lead here. We're burying the lead.
Yes.
We're staving off.
I still, WandaVision's still my
favorite.
Why don't
you go ahead?
So I watched the finale on the airplane on my teeny tiny phone next to my husband, who does not care about any of the Marvel TV shows, and he was asleep. And then that one scene, if you haven't seen it yet, skip ahead a minute. So
3, 2, 1.
When he said mutations, I didn't even hear the X-Men thing because I was so like, I'm literally like looking around. Like, did anybody else hear that? Even though my headphones are in my head or in my ears and I'm holding my teeny tiny phone.
Yes, yes.
I was like, they played the
X-Men theme song from the show. They played the X-Men theme song when he said mutations. She's a mutant.
And it's kind of funny too, though, because like in the comics, she's an inhuman, but there was, when she met Wolverine, she said, maybe I'm a mutant. And like, obviously she wasn't in the comic, but they are going route now.
Well, the funny thing is when she was first introduced, they wanted to make her a mutant, but he who shall not be named at the time said,
Mephisto?
No, she's going to be inhuman. Yes. So they made her an inhuman, which never made sense to begin with because she should have been a mutant. And so now it's like Kevin Feige is retconning this, rectifying it. He said, hey, play the theme song during this part, and he didn't tell anybody anything else.
So
it's exciting. We got mutants. We got freaking mutants.
So with that being said, after my daughter watched it, I'm like, it's time for the 10-year-old to watch the first X-Men 2000. And I put it on, and about 10 minutes in, she goes, so when does something exciting happen?
Oh,
so now she's at a local adoption agency. If anybody is interested in an obnoxious 10-year-old.
Look, she does great housework. It helps out. She just might make really poor.
She can teach you
opinions.
How to make TikToks. She has.
That's true.
That
she
is
the director of our TikTok.
She helps me tremendously with editing of my videos. But yeah, and then I was like, don't you want to see why your brother's, why your brother's named Logan? Like, this is where it started. Like, I watched the movies before I ever read a comic. No, she didn't give a fuck.
But maybe one day she will. Maybe one day.
My mom can dream.
The second post-credit scene.
My oldest, though, does. Oh, yeah. What the hell?
She swaps places with Carol Danvers, a.k.a. Captain Marvel, which is going to lead straight into the Marvels. And it seems like maybe the Negabands, things like that. The Kree, maybe after the Negabands. Who knows? But
what was that?
She's got a new look.
Freaky Friday thing, though. I was so confused.
Yeah. Well, she swapped places. For some reason, her bangle swapped places with them, which is going to get explained in the Marvels. Don't worry. It's already been announced.
Has that happened in the comics before that you know of?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, there's, I'd have to brush up, but there is a sequence where like the bangles cause people to swap places, things like that. And there's some weird things going on. And it has to do with the Negabands, which I will fix next week because I didn't look deep enough into that at the moment. I can't remember off the top of my head. Oh, no. But yes, that has happened in the comics before. And so I think what's going to probably happen is this is going to set up with something with the Kree. And then what happens from the Kree is I think this is going to go into Secret Wars somehow, because I think with the Kree and stuff like that, and the big rumor coming out of San Diego Comic-Con this weekend is they're going to be announcing Secret Wars. Of course, when this airs, we'll already maybe know if that's true or not.
A lot of people have been saying that for a while now.
Right. Well, they're filming the TV show. But that's different than the movie and everything that they're setting up. So we'll see. It's cool. She got a new suit. She's basically got,
a better
gloves,
haircut.
The 3-quarter baseball tee going on. And so, yeah, I'm excited. So that was my thoughts. It's my favorite. I know WandaVision's yours. I really enjoyed it. Other
They've
than
all
that.
Been fantastic, though. I have nothing bad to say about all. Oh, there's five
right.
now.
The only thing I can really complain about is some of the series feel like they should be 8 episodes, because it feels like once they get to episode 4, they're kind of like, oh crap, we have to finish this up in 2 episodes. So we kind of have to like, okay, and everyone survived the end. And that's how it feels.
I get what you're saying. And I totally feel that, because it's always like, how are they going to do all this in the last one? But it's also like, these stories aren't over at all. This is, a hiatus for all of them. Like even WandaVision, it was... No, she just went right into Doctor Strange. We're not going to get another WandaVision. Yeah. That'd be kind of I mean, she's going to take over another town, but her story is, you know, definitely not done. So I feel like that's why they do it. It's like, they want to keep you on edge. And like, you know, with the ending of Moon Knight, which I won't say because that's one show a lot of people really haven't finished. So I don't, and I highly recommend
that's when people are sleeping on big time.
So I don't want to say what was in the last, you know, end credit scene for Moon Knight, because anybody who hasn't watched it should definitely watch it. And I know it gets confusing in the beginning, but like, just lean into it. And I loved it. I thought it was great. I loved every single episode. I loved being confused because the main actor was confused, or the main character was confused. But I also watched another amazing thing this past week on the plane ride home. I watched Morbius finally.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is your captain speaking. Once we reach the cruising altitude of 35,000 feet, it's Morbin time.
And
Lauren got morbed.
It met every expectation I could have imagined.
Did you have expectations? Were you expecting anything? Did it really, though?
You know what the thing I was the most dissatisfied with, and it all has to do with expectations, because I really went into it knowing it wasn't going to be a great movie, having very low expectations, even though I love Matt Smith. It was so weird to see, you know, he's my second favorite doctor. It was very weird to see him like that. Michael Keaton.
He knew what movie he was in.
So Michael Keaton was bad in this. He's not bad in anything.
Everybody was bad.
How was he bad in this?
There was no redeeming. Nothing was redeeming.
I mean, it was worth a watch. I already knew like some of what was going to happen because everything like leaked right away. But Michael Keaton was in the trailer, which didn't even make sense as to like, I'm not even going to go into it because like that should have been a shocking thing, but he was in the freaking trailer.
Yeah. And it was.
That's it. We did a whole comic origin episode on him, and that was enough.
We did. I say no more. I watched half the Bob's Burgers movie.
You know, I've never watched that show.
I didn't finish it yet, though. It's good so far.
I've heard good
things. You know what show I did finish that you really should be watching is an FX original on Hulu called The Bear. And it is fantastic. It's got the kid. He was in Shameless. I never watched that show, but apparently that's where he's from.
Fantastic. He's a great Shameless. Actor. Yeah, he's a great actor.
Yeah. Well, his brother dies, and I'm not going to spoil who his brother was because he's a very well-known actor.
Oh.
And it's very, very heart-wrenching. But his brother commits suicide, and so he's left with the restaurant. He was previously running the kitchen at the world's most renowned restaurant in New York City. He's a very talented chef, and now he's taking over this beef house in Chicago. And it's episode 7 of that season. So it got renewed for season 2.
Is the whole season 1 out?
So yes, all 8 episodes are out. Episode 7 is probably one of the best shot episodes, and it just continuously builds. It's very short. It's all one shot.
Huh.
And so it's very short, but the way it builds tension and builds and builds and builds and builds and builds, it was one of the better episodes of television that I've seen in a very long time. So I can't recommend that show enough. Very, very good. And a show that I want you to steer very clear from, like you run away. Resident Evil on Netflix. Holy mother of God. I was like, I'm bored on the plane. Or no, I decided not to watch on the plane. I was home on Monday and I was like, I'm going to watch the first episode. Whoa, okay. The games, I'm fine if you don't follow the source material for games and things. But the writing is very childish. The writing was just amateur hour over there. You have these characters that you just cannot bring yourself to care about. And it goes between building action pace to now you're doing a flashback. And if you have to put like half your episode, and this is every single episode in this season, I think all 8 episodes, half the episodes are flashbacks. And if you have to do that for your series, not in a proper way, because this isn't Arrow season 1. This is just, it was bad. It was really bad. You hate the characters. There's just nothing redeeming about this show. And that's all I'm going to say about that. So that's all I've been reading, watching. I'm still working my way through Shadows of the Sith. I don't know what's taking me so long in that book.
There was one my cousin recommended. I did read. I'm only halfway through with Brotherhood. I did read that on the plane on the way there, but I was too hungover to read anything on the way home.
Yeah, I could not read. I was trying to sleep the whole plane.
I know. I thought I was going to come home and that book was going to be done.
So did I. That was my thought. I'm like, I'm bringing my book because I'm going to finish on these plane right? rides. That was a lie.
I'm going to see because my cousin, she read Brotherhood and loved it. And she was recommending another Star Wars one. If I can, I don't know why none of this is working. If I can find it.
There's Princess and the Scoundrel coming out, which is about Han and Leia's wedding.
Oh, how cute. And
there's another one called Star Wars Padawan, which is Obi-Wan is a Padawan as well, that I'm going to be picking up too.
Star Wars Dark Disciple by Christy Golden.
That, oh yes, Dark Disciple is a fantastic book. You have to read that one.
Okay.
That should be your next read right there. Star Wars Dark Disciple.
Okie dokie. Screenshotted really it. Okay.
Before we go into news, do you have anything else?
Nope. Oh, I have Ghostwriter, but right. I still haven't finished it. I don't know what's wrong with me. Every time I put it on, it falls asleep. I've never watched it. It's the Nick Cage one. It's so bad. It's probably worse than Morbius.
The first one's not bad. It's a product of the early 2000s.
I was
going to
say, when was the last time you watched it? The way they treat Eva Mendes is just fucking brutal.
That's true. That's okay. That's
my husband's like, are you not enjoying it? Cause for one, he was shocked. I had never seen it. He's like, I've seen this. How have you not? It's a Marvel movie.
I'm honestly surprised you hadn't either.
I think it was just
honest.
One of those, like, I remember seeing the commercial and I don't know. I never got around to it. And it came out right before Iron Man. It came out the year before. So like I was already, you know, I was big into the X-Men movies and the Sam Raimi Spider-Man. And I don't know. It just never really like thrilled me, I guess. And Josh is like, do you even like this? Every time I put it on, you're out in like 10 minutes. It should be like my sleepy time show. It's like, oh man, I can't go to sleep. I'm put on Ghost Rider. It's really bad. It's so bad. That might be my least favorite. I mean, I don't want to say it's worse than the new Fantastic Four.
Oh,
it's worse
God,
than 2003
yeah.
Hulk. All right. You got a lot of news. Why don't you do your news?
All right. Let's roll into some news. News time. So first things first, Deadpool 1 and 2 and Logan are now out on Disney Plus. So I've password protected my Disney Plus account. I'm going to have to change that password a lot because that's the last thing I need is my six-year-old walking in being like, Dad, what's International Women's Day?
Logan's going to be like, look, it says my name. I'm going to watch this. And there's like claws through the freaking guy's head in the first scene.
Dad, what's pegging? Oh, God. Well, son, let me tell you. So Bradley Cooper will be returning to voice Rocket in the Groot series.
Oh,
now, this dude, he's never stepped foot on set and he doesn't even go to like the premieres and stuff. But this man is raking in the Marvel dough for very little work. And I always forget that
premieres?
He's voicing.
That just seems
he's
silly.
He's a busy man. I don't know. Him and Vin Diesel lend their voice to these characters. And so I know the Groot series is going to be very short, mini episodes geared towards kids. So don't get your hopes and expectations up.
Don't
it's
start slamming
friendly.
It on the internet.
Yeah. As soon as it releases, don't be like, I was expecting it to be this, that, because that's the hot topic to do. Just know it's very short series, very short episodes, and it's very much kid friendly. However, Kurt and Wyatt Russell might not be very kid friendly because they are going to be in the Apple TV Godzilla series, which takes place after Godzilla 2014. Not sure what their characters are.
Are they playing father
Not
and
sure
son?
What this series is necessarily about. I mean, that or I can see them maybe doing flashbacks. Like, what if Wyatt Russell is the flashback version of Kurt
maybe.
Russell? That'd be kind of cool.
Wyatt's chin is just too big to be the younger version of his dad.
Yeah. I don't know. But I'm interested. If it's got Godzilla in it, I'm interested. I just hope that I don't know if Godzilla is really going to be in it. I hope he is if it's a Godzilla series. So
the weirdest
we'll see.
He wasn't.
Christina Ricci, back from the dead.
Love
and
her.
Billy Magnuson.
Why do you say back from the dead? She was in Yellow Jackets.
I watched two episodes of that, so I guess you're right. Okay, my bad. She was in Yellow Jackets. Just because I haven't seen it doesn't mean that a lot of people have.
We're not waking the
me.
Dead. Get it? Wake the dead.
That's right. So the dead speak. And they're going to be the voices of Harley and Joker in the new DC podcast Spotify series, because you know what? Batman isn't satisfied with pummeling Joker to death. He has to come for low level indie podcasters and take our spotlights as well. But at least it's not Joe Rogan.
Everyone has a podcast now. Even the celebrities. Come
even
on,
fucking
man.
Fucking Batman has a podcast now. Like, we can't have nothing.
I heard
nice.
There's a Lord of the Rings one that's supposedly really good.
Is there?
Huh. Yeah, I can send you the thing. Ian and Tabby were talking about it.
Can't wait for Lord of the Rings. So, yeah, they have a podcast Spotify series. The second Batman one's going to be out there. And then Something that I don't agree with is that the creators of Yelena signed a contract in 2007 and that they were entitled to $25,000 from Marvel for each Black Widow film. Huh. However, they only have been awarded $5,000, and this was in November. So Marvel likes to lowball their comic creators and these characters that are created. It's like $5,000 is the standard for whatever reason. And so the creators of, you know, Yelena thought they were getting $25,000. They signed on for a contract, but Marvel's lowballing them. It's a really big issue because they're using these characters. They're making
billions of dollars.
Exactly. Like $5,000 to somebody who put their heart and soul like into drawing these characters, into writing these characters, the least you could do is properly compensate them.
Yeah.
Like $25,000 isn't a lot either when you're talking Marvel movies making $500 to $1 billion. Like I get there's other people that have to make money, but Marvel's not hurting for money.
Right. Anything if there's one under thing Marvel's Disney. Not,
it's right. And that just does not sit well with me. I really hope maybe they revisit some of this stuff and they start to pay their creators properly.
Like they went through this shit with Scarlett Johansson. Like, come on, guys.
Exactly. What's up like they with don't this movie? Learn their lesson, it feels like. It sucks.
Yeah, I really like that movie. So anybody who is into Lord of the Rings, it's called the Friendship Onion Podcast, and it's on Spotify, and it's Pip and Mary from Lord of the Rings. Really good. You can tell they're genuinely good friends. They just had Michael Rosenbaum on, and it was pretty funny. I guess there's not like a specific topic every week. I guess maybe they kind of bullshit. I'm literally like reading the text chain. It's supposed to be the supernatural text and they're talking about Lord of the Rings. So there you go.
Ah, well, that's cool. Well, okay. Tell them to come to our text chain then. You guys always stick to the supernatural. Maybe I want to get involved.
Well, I gotta start then one with your boy. And take out Jess. It's a lot of work. So many text chains. What else do we got? Okay.
Well, I'm sorry you're so popular over there. Like some of us don't have friends, all right?
You know who else doesn't have friends? Poor Ted Lasso.
Ooh. Oh, why you gotta do this? So, yes, they are halfway done filming the final season of Ted Lasso. And my heart's going to break.
I know, this makes me sad. It wasn't enough.
It's like the... It sucks because this is like one of the most wholesome, best shows out there. It's on Apple TV. So I get it if you don't want to have another subscription service, but this is so worth it. It is such a heart-filling show. Everybody is so good. And your man, Brett Goldstein, happens to be in the Marvel Cinematic Universe now too. So
spoilers. Not if you don't say who he is.
Yeah.
You know, and Apple said, though, every time Ted Lasso came on, their subscriptions skyrocketed and then their viewing on other TV shows went up, too. So you would think that they would be doing everything humanly possible to keep Ted Lasso going. But I mean, if I know that we did a whole Ted Lasso episode,
I think
a while ago.
Yeah, they only planned for it to be 3 seasons. Yeah. So
it's so short. It. That's so short.
We complain about shows going on for too long. They're getting out while the getting's good. So I respect it.
Here's the thing. As long as it's still good, like Supernatural was 15 seasons and I don't feel like it was too long. But then like Once Upon a Time went too long because they jumped the shark. You just have to get off before you jump the shark. That's it.
Right.
And I guess it's hard to tell that. But I mean, 3 seasons, like you're nowhere near the shark. You can't even see the shark. You're still on the beach.
That's true. Well, I have the Hugh Jackman news. Hot off the press that we have all been waiting for.
Ugh, don't say that. That sounds mean.
Are you ready?
That sounds really mean. It's not the Wolverine,
Hugh
Jack guys.
News we have all been waiting for. He has been cast as Koala Man in an animated film from Michael Cusack and the co-creator of Rick and Morty, Justin Roiland.
I don't even know what that
is. That's the news, right? Like that's what we've been waiting for.
Yeah, it definitely is. Oh. I loved him in Old Man Koala Man.
He's a drop bear, all right? So, yeah, whatever that means, he's going to be in it. So, moving on, Tom Holland will not voice Peter Parker in Spider-Man Freshman Year. We got our first look at San Diego Comic-Con this past weekend. Nintendo now has its own anime studio, so expect things coming from them. And, last but certainly not least, Grand Moff Tarkin will allegedly appear in Andor, which is set to release August 31st, 2022 on Disney+. And that's all I have for news.
So my only piece of news is beer news and geek news. So I did mention this if you caught our Hops News episode last Thursday. This is a quote from Brewbound, which is a website. Quote, California Wild Ales, San Diego Sour House, and the city's only barrel-aged American sour brewery announced its fourth annual Comic-Con tap takeover. The brewery calls all space travelers, supervillains, gamers, Trekkies, Jedi, zombies, intergalactic bounty hunters, and more to stop by its Ocean Beach tasting room from July 24th to the 21st to the 24th. This is in the past. However, hold on a minute. It's going to be a Comic-Con themed beer release and costume contest. So one of the beers is Buzz Lightyear, which is a cold brew beer, and they're going to have a Shang-Chi made with their homemade chai tea blend. And if you want to check out any of the pictures, I will definitely be looking at this. They said to tweet at them California Wild Ales to see the pictures. So I'm sure that that brewery is going to be tagged in some amazing cosplay. I mean, because San Diego, I mean, they go above and beyond. It's got to be the best.
I can't wait to share pictures from that. It's going to be amazing.
So yeah, California Wild Ales on Instagram. So check that out. Check out their pictures they've been tagged in. And I'm sure you will not be disappointed, because at this point, all of that is in the past.
No. So
that's all I got.
Shall we dive into our main topic in honor of Shark Week? Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, I present to you Jaws. Starring Roy Scheider as Martin Brody, Robert Shaw as Quint, Richard Dreyfuss as Matt Hooper, Jaws was released June 20th, 1975 from director Steven Spielberg. It is based on the novel named Jaws by Peter Benchley. So, film producers got the rights to this movie before the movie came out. They actually discovered the movie while looking at a random bookstore one night, and they took it home and they read it in a night. Because in the cover, the front cover, it said might make a good movie someday. And so they took this home and they read it in one night, and they agreed that it would make a decent movie. There's a lot of good plot elements. And so they went ahead, got the rights.
Right, they got it before the book came out. My bad.
Exactly. They got the rights, but they happened upon this movie, the bookstore, all that kind of stuff. So the book actually has some subplots. However, the movie took the main plot, which is going after a man-eating shark that was 16 feet in the book. However, in the movie, it is 25 feet. And funny enough, Peter Benchley got kicked off the set for being upset with Steven Spielberg because of the changes that they were making in the movie.
They did make friends in the end, though.
They did. And it's just funny. Well, it's hard. You put your life into a book. Somebody comes and makes it a movie. Hollywood does Hollywood things. I understand. I get it. You know, every time something that's your baby, it means a lot to you. So if somebody's going to change it and take liberties with it, it's hard.
Well, and there was stuff that was big in the book. But one, you know, interesting, because I looked up, like, what's the biggest shark ever recorded in real life? And it's a female named Deep Blue, and she is 20 feet. So this went, you know, 5 feet over. And I actually had Jaws on earlier.
Megalodon's bigger.
I had Jaws on earlier, and my son said, the biggest shark is a megalodon. And I'm like, you do know that's a dinosaur shark and it doesn't exist anymore. He's like, no, it still exists. I'm like, okay.
He's like, I saw Jurassic Park. Dominion, mom. It exists. Okay.
So a few of the differences, though, that were pulled out was, one, the men came home each night. So it wasn't like they were out at sea overnight and whatnot. In the book, Brody is more aggressive. Both movie and book, he's from New York City, but he's more passive. He's the heart of the movie. Like, he's who we relate to. But one of the big things they took out is the mayor actually had ties with the mob. So that made it make more sense as to why he was so adamant with keeping the beaches opened. He does say, like, Amity is, they need summer. Like, summer is their Black Friday. They make all their money in the summer. So you shut down the beaches and people are going to go elsewhere. But having him be related to the mob, I mean, that's more scary. It's like, you got to keep the beaches open because the mob wanted to keep the beaches open. Otherwise, the property values would go down and they would lose money.
Right. So this takes place in the book, because I haven't read the book. This takes place in Mass still, right?
I don't know exactly. I think it's still a fictional town of Amityville. I don't know that.
Well, Amity. So yeah. So regardless if it does, so Amity, Massachusetts. So assuming it takes place the same place in the book, it makes sense that during the summer they want the most money, because if you know anything about Massachusetts, is it gets wicked cold in the wintertime, snow, all that. And you're not bringing tourists in to the Cape in the wintertime, whereas summertime traffic is packed. Everything is slamming. So I get it. The ties to the mob, that's totally different. But yeah, that's your moneymaker in the Northeast, because you have such a short window, being that the winter lasts forever.
Yeah, that sounds terrible. But yeah, they filmed in Martha's Vineyard. But another big thing that they did in the book that they didn't do in the movie was Brody's wife and Hooper have an affair, which there was never any. I'm
glad that serves nothing. That doesn't serve anything to the plot.
Right. But I mean, movies are shorter than books. So, I mean, it makes sense that they would take that out because, well, I mean, you had Brody was angry too. Like if her having an affair in the movie would have been odd because, I don't know, it didn't fit his personality. The guy from the local paper is actually played by the screenwriter Carl Gottlieb. And he said it was funny because when he was writing the script, he had to take his part, like his character, out. He goes, "That was really hard to write out my character, but my character, it didn't make sense for him to have such a big role as he did in the book and the movie." And the person who wrote the book, Peter, he's the reporter on the beach.
Oh, no way. That's cool.
Yeah. So they did cute little things. I didn't know that.
Well, something they did was Quint's USS Indianapolis speech was actually not in the book. And this is something that I love as a history nerd. It's a real event. So during World War II, they were coming home from delivering parts to the atomic bomb and they got hit by a kamikaze Japanese jet. Plane wasn't a jet at that time. This was classified for 30 years. So they got surrounded by sharks. Guys were drinking salt water, going insane.
Never drink salt water.
A lot of the accounts were like they would huddle close together to hopefully they can fight off the sharks and things like that. But they were out there for 4.5 days. Friends were dying. They would hear screams all through the night and things, which is how they knew that their friends were getting eaten, because they would hear their screams, stuff like that. There's actually a 2007 documentary on Discovery Channel called Ocean of Fear. It states that the sinking of the Indianapolis resulted in the most shark attacks on human history and attributes the attacks to the oceanic white-tip shark species, although tiger sharks may have also killed some sailors. And the actor did the first shot completely drunk and then came back the next day sober, and they ended up taking pieces from both of it. And then also a couple of the survivors said they really appreciated that scene, which there's a Nicolas Cage movie, I believe it is too, about this. But oh, yeah, really? Like, I can't imagine. You're in the middle of the ocean. That's my biggest fear, first and foremost. And then you're getting eaten by sharks. Your friends are getting eaten by sharks and there's nothing you can do about it.
Yeah. And these are deep sea sharks, and it's very rare that you would be in that situation. But I watched the documentary, and it's crazy listening to these guys, like, you know, get choked up and whatnot. And what was really interesting about it is at the end of the documentary, half of them are like, you know, "I don't blame sharks. I have nothing against sharks. I respect sharks. We were in their territory." And the other half are like, "Sharks are mindless eating machines, and kill them all." And I understand both perspectives. Yeah. Like, I'm a huge shark advocate. Going in the ocean does not scare me in the least. But if I had a traumatic experience, yeah, it's like after I got into my first car accident, I didn't drive for a couple of weeks, you know? So I get that.
Exactly. It's, I would definitely be messed up from it too. So, the end of the book, Hooper is actually the one that dies. Brody isn't the one to kill the creature. Quint is. He shoots multiple harpoons into the great white shark, and it dies as a swim towards Brody. Quint also dies when he's drugged down with the dead shark. Very different than the ending we got, of course.
Yes, and part of Hooper surviving, I'm actually going to talk about in the end, was not originally planned. But yeah, in the movie, anybody who doesn't remember, Hooper's underwater with a scuba tank. Quint ends up getting eaten, and then Brody ends up shooting him, and he explodes.
Right. So it's actually funny because he's in the shark cage, and then the cage gets destroyed, and then he just like disappears from the movie. And then all of a sudden he resurfaces, like, and he's like, "Oh, hey, man, what'd I miss?
Those bastards killed Kenny." Oh, wait.
So starting at the beginning of the movie, though, it's always funny because the Boston accents, when they try to do the Boston, like the number one thing everybody does when they're like, you're from Boston, they go, oh, pack my car. Is that how you say it? And it's this, oh, just drives me nuts. And of course they do it in this because they're in Massachusetts. But also, don't go swimming at night, folks. Like the dawn and dusk, that's when these sharks and things typically are feeding.
Yeah.
And for more than that, Massachusetts, that water is cold as shit.
Yeah.
So power to everybody swimming in this water, because I remember being numb in that water. I don't care how hot it is out there. It is cold.
Yeah. They're and then one sitting last on thing the I beach wanna... with sweaters.
Yeah. Like, and then one last thing before we really dive in is the PG rating for this movie. This movie is rated PG,
how
which
the
in 1975
fuck?
Ratings were a bit skewed. But yeah, this movie's PG.
That's insanity to me. I honestly just assumed it was like R. My God, it is PG. That is insanity. It says it has an MPAA rating, though. Isn't that like mature audience on TV?
Yes. I mean, there's blood and stuff. This isn't a PG movie you're showing to 3-year-olds now. This isn't Buzz Lightyear. This isn't Toy Story. No.
Oh my gosh, that's too funny. Well, the 80s movies, yeah, don't fuck with the babysitter, wasn't that? Oh, I think we just talked about that. I think that one is PG-13.
Yeah.
But yeah, so the opening scene is the girl Chrissy, you know, she's running in the ocean, and the actress, they actually had underwater cables tied to her, and they wouldn't warn her, and they would just pull her in different directions, so she was screaming and not knowing what was going on.
Chrissy,
and then this is pretty rough.
I don't like
the whole time
it.
Steven Spielberg, though, was in the water with her. Yeah, this one's for Chrissy. So to get the drowning sound in post-production, she was placed in front of a microphone with her head turned up to the ceiling and water was poured down her throat from above.
They waterboarded their actress? Oh my God, for a 30-second scene
so
that she's
Richard
in?
Dreyfuss actually said in a documentary that Steven is guilty of a war crime.
They waterboarded this poor girl. She's like, I'm getting my first big break in a Steven Spielberg film, Jaws.
Well, he
and
wasn't really Steven Spielberg then, but yeah.
Well, no, but still, like, what was your first movie? Steven Spielberg, who are you? I got eaten by a shark and they waterboarded me in the beginning of this movie. Like, oh my God.
She paid her dues. Well, what was kind of cool, I don't know how many people know this, but so when they cast her, they said they're like, we need somebody who's tough, beautiful, and willing to get naked. And they said that was a hard combination. So they found this woman, her name's Susan Baclini, and she's an actress, and she's actually one of the Weeki-Wachee mermaids at the state park in Florida, which I've taken my kids there. They do a whole mermaid show. Little Mermaid show, and it's actually underwater. And it's really cool. It's in like a spring-fed thing. It's like old school Florida. So it's really old, and they have like a few water slides into the springs, but they swim through tunnels, and then so they come up and you're like, you're sitting in chairs and you're watching basically a giant aquarium, but it's these women dressed as mermaids and they're breathing through little tubes that they're holding, and they're doing the whole movie of, or the whole story of the Little Mermaid. It's
That's interesting.
So cool. I loved it. It's north of Tampa. It's really cool. So she was a mermaid and she was also an animal trainer. So they showed like pictures of her like petting tigers and stuff. So she's actually in Tiger King. Not really, but maybe, who knows? So that's who they cast. And yeah, kudos to this woman. Looked terrible.
I have on her. One of the things that's really good about this movie I found is they do a great job. They tell you, they don't show you a lot. It's like you barely see the shark at all, but the blood that they show in the water, the suspense that they do building up, like that first scene with where they zoom in on Brody and everyone's getting out the water because there's sharks, but it turns out to be the two kids, of course. Or
oh my God, before, those kids are lucky they didn't get shot.
Yeah, I mean, nobody's taking it seriously. And what's funny about this is there's actually a ton of great white sightings all the time up there in Cape Cod and things like that. So I always find that funny. But like,
yeah, but they don't care about you. Like,
it's very modern day too. Like how many people, like a shark attack, okay, whatever, it's fine. It's fine. You're going to blow it off. Think of like all the things, COVID and stuff that we've had. Everyone's like, yeah, whatever. Global warming. Yeah, whatever.
Oh, we'll get to the end. We talk about all the animals that have killed more people than sharks.
Right. Exactly. And the fact that the shark is just so bloodthirsty that it hunts everybody down too is just hilarious to me, because the shark had to have been a robotic mind controlled shark, because no shark is just straight out finding people to eat all the time and attacking boats and things.
Well, and that was part of the issue too, with like how so many people got like terrified of the ocean and angry at sharks and were literally mass slaughtering sharks. And the guy who wrote the book, was like, look, this is a fictional shark. This is not real. Like this. Yeah, that is not normal to have a great white that is literally like out for human blood. They don't want humans. Most of the time when people die from a shark attack, it's a bite and a swim away. But if they bite you on your carotid artery or, you know, I'm not a doctor, you could bleed out. And obviously the bigger the shark, the worse that is, which is like Florida is, you know, we have we're the shark bite capital of the world in New Smyrna. But your chances of surviving are very high here because it's usually, you know, like a, I don't know, black tip or
they
a mistake or
you
a lemon.
For food. So they come up, they try to bite you and then they realize that they're not, you're not
they're
a
like
seal.
They're like toddlers. They're checking things out. And if you push them on the nose, usually they'll just swim away. I've never pushed a shark on. Well, I mean, yeah, I've never pushed a shark on the nose, but that's what I see on Shark Week. Just put your hand out and push it away. The only shark I've ever touched was a nurse shark, but they don't count. They're like puppies.
No, they're docile as can be. So there were actually two orcas in this movie. So they sunk one
of them.
Orca's
the name of the boat.
And then
if
the
you
other
don't
one was the crew. Yes. We're going to need a bigger boat. Coast Guard, this is the orca. One started to sink before it was supposed to, and they actually saved the cameras, rinsed them in fresh water, and sent it to Kodak immediately. So that's how they got some of those shots, which is pretty cool. And the sound guy said, fuck the actors, save the sound department.
That was pretty funny when I watched that on the documentary because the sound guy was like 75 and Richard Dreyfuss is like, you know, the sound guy's 75, you know, save him. And the sound guy goes, that's a wrap on the sound department.
Well, apparently Richard Dreyfuss was out there enjoying himself some local women because that's what
he was
doing
like
the 26, entire filming.
27. Yeah.
Isn't it funny how old, like in the 70s, these 25, 26 year olds look, whereas compared now it's totally a different world. Moisturizer, folks.
Moisturizer. Also too, all these people who look like they were in their 40s and 50s had young kids. And I know not, you know, everybody starts at different ages, but like the mom who lost her son, I mean, she looked like she was like 60 and she had a 12-year-old.
Yeah.
That's not totally unreasonable. That'd be like,
No, but you're right. Like almost all the people you see, there was no real young looking people. They all looked pretty old.
Yeah. Even Brody, who's like 40 something when they did this, he had like a 2-year-old or something that they're just letting run amok. But
they left their 2-year-old sitting on the beach unaccompanied and they're just like, okay, whatever.
So,
he's out there playing in the boat.
I feel like we hear this with so many movies that we consider classics and we're like, how did anybody have any doubt on this? We've heard it about Star Wars. We've heard it about Back to the Future, all these movies. So there was a lot of talk in Hollywood about this being the end of Spielberg's career because it was so over budget and time. In fact, it was 100% over budget and they did twice as much time as they thought they were going to, but this was like the first real movie filmed on the ocean. They're like, oh, you're going to film in a lake? Oh, you're going to film on a set in a pool? And he's like, no, I want to film in the Atlantic where I want it to look real. And they had to accommodate the weather and they had to accommodate the shark that wasn't working. And you mentioned like the shark doesn't show up until an hour and 20 minutes in. And that wasn't the original intention. You were supposed to see the shark in the opening scene, but Bruce, which is the name of the shark, because that's Steven Spielberg's lawyer's name. And that is where Bruce gets his name from Nemo, wasn't cooperating. And it's funny because, you know, you see that with the T-Rex years later in Jurassic Park, where he's like shaking and having a seizure. And they said the shark worked great in the fresh water when they were testing him. And it was the salt water. It just wasn't working. So he made the scariest freaking shark movie ever because you don't see the shark until an hour and 20 minutes.
Exactly. You build suspense, which was inadvertently great. And speaking of something that wasn't working, Hooper kept crashing the boat. So he was supposed to drive up in his little boat when you first see him, yet he kept crashing it. So they just had him climb out of the boat.
I think that's hilarious. Apparently he was very high maintenance when they made this and not anything like a marine biologist at all.
Oh, I kind of can see that. I can see that very much, actually, which is hilarious again.
So the mom who slaps Brody, she had to slap him about 17 times. And she said that people will still come up to her and ask her to slap them. And
this is their fetish.
Yeah. I feel like you hear that quite a lot. But like the actor who played him, he's like, after the first take, it was really hard to pretend like I didn't know it was coming.
Well, yeah, because you're 17 times being slapped, like, after a while.
I wasn't all red.
No kidding, right? Was this, like, in a row? 17 slaps in a row, or did they take a break? I'm very curious.
I don't know. Maybe they should have done it like the slap bet, where, like, he didn't know when it was coming.
Oh, yeah, that's a good... Or, like, those slap competitions. I don't know. So the people filming, or the ocean filming for this film, sorry, was a nightmare. Anchors were getting dragged. People on sailboats kept getting in the frame. You couldn't obviously cut them out with CGI and things because this was 75. You can't have sailors in the background having fun while somebody's actually getting eaten by a shark. I mean, that would have been hilarious. There's just people sailing in the background having the time of their freaking lives. Well, it would have been very on brand, though. You just have people drunk out there sailboating while someone's getting eaten by a shark, not knowing what's going on.
But they said they would have to, like, reasonable. Stop filming and then just hope that another sailboat didn't show up before this sailboat got out of frame.
It's like, my God.
But it had to look like they were out in the ocean.
Shut it all down. Well, yeah. Like, so I'm surprised they didn't shut down, because modern movies would have been like, you can't come in this area.
Yeah. Well, I guess the locals were already upset about how much they blocked off to make the movie was on land.
Martha's Vineyard, their whole thing. If you shut down for a day, you're losing a ton of money.
And they were shut down. I mean, they were filming like all summer.
Yeah. So apparently Quint and Hooper had a lot of animosity toward each other on set. On set, they had a lot of animosity. Meanwhile, offset, Hooper, Richard Dreyfuss, said that he was the nicest guy and Quint was just a man possessed on set, which is funny because you're actually rooting for Quint to die in this movie because he's such an asshole.
Oh, he's an asshole, but like you respect him at the same time.
That's true. He's an old war veteran.
Yeah. And when he tells the US and obviously I didn't know that story the first time I watched the movie, and after having watched that documentary and then rewatching it, like that was a great, you know, piece of real history to put in there and really give this guy character. And, you know, it's like a Vietnam vet. Like, you know, this guy's seen some shit.
Yeah. I mean, it was great. So it is funny how actors can turn it on and off set. So I like that. That's pretty sweet.
Yeah. So Hooper pulled a license plate out of the tiger shark. So I don't know if you remember when they thought they caught the shark. It was not a shark. Yep. It was a tiger shark. And what's funny is they weren't able to capture a shark that big in Martha's Vineyard. So they caught this tiger shark in Florida, then packed him on ice and put him on a jet all the way up to Cape Cod to get him there as quick as possible. But they said he was smelling real quick. And I tried to pay attention because I read, like, if you look close, you can see some of the extras like being like, oh my God, that smells terrible. I didn't notice that, but I was also looking at this poor dead tiger shark and just feeling bad for him.
They killed the shark for the sole thing of the movie. That's pretty brutal.
People do shark competitions still, where they still go out and they freaking kill sharks and they hang them up and it's terrible. It's absolutely terrible. It should be illegal. They used
an animatronic shark. Why couldn't they do that for this? Like, you could have made a fake shark.
I think they wanted something that looked real. I don't really know. But they, you know, Richard Dreyfuss, who is the marine biologist, he says their digestive systems are slow. You need to make sure this is the real shark. Cut his belly open, you know, see if anybody's in there. And they cut it open and they find a license plate. And anybody who's watched any Shark Week probably knows, like, tiger sharks will eat the most random of shit. And they have have found license plates in their tummies. And they have also, one tiger shark was found with a metal armor suit. I don't know if there was a person in it when he ate it. I mean, tiger sharks don't get that huge.
It's just a flesh wound.
I mean, they get big. But so I've always, anytime they say that fun fact on Shark Week, I'm just like, how in the hell?
Right. Yeah,
they're like they eat everything. The dumpster of the ocean, eater of the ocean. Toddlers
where they just eat and they eat and they eat.
Yeah. So this one is kind of interesting. So the head scare, I don't know if you remember when Hooper jumps into the ocean and he's like, let me just check out the shipwreck. So Quint was actually inspired by this guy named Craig Kinsbury, and he makes a cameo as a local fisherman named Ben Gardner. Well, this guy's head, his disembodied head, is the one that pops out of the sunken porthole. And the head scene did not come out well, so they reshot it in a pool and they poured milk into the pool to make it look like a cloudy ocean.
Oh, weird. Movie magic, folks. Speaking of movie magic, this movie won 3 Academy Awards. They won Best Film Editing, Best Original Dramatic Score, which the score is very underrated in this movie. And obviously, the theme song is the most iconic next to something like Indiana Jones, Star Wars. Anytime you hear this theme song, you know what it's from, whether you've seen the movie or not. And then it won Best Sound. again, I think this movie did really well as far as sound, score, and the way they shot the movie. And funny enough, we already talked about it, but the idea of barely showing the monster and creating that intense anticipation wasn't the original plan. So that was really, really cool. Jaws was supposed to be seen in the very first scene. It only worked in freshwater tanks. And then for the underwater things, they built a box with glass. The camera went into the box. And yeah, so all that kind of thing that goes on behind the scenes, I find fascinating. And then someone actually snuck on the set and got a picture of Bruce with the mechanical side showing, and they put it in Time magazine. Of course, Steven wasn't happy, and he thought this was showing who Oz was, and no one would want to come to his movie.
So the script was actually written while the movie was being filmed, and the actors got to contribute a little bit. And they would often like wrap filming, and then Steven Spielberg and the writers would go and sit down and figure out what they were going to film the next day and the dialogue for that.
That's so crazy to me. Like, could you imagine? Yeah, we've got something, but we're going to go ahead and write this movie as it goes. And it turns out to be the one of the biggest, most iconic films of all time.
Spielberg said he still has nightmares about when he was making this movie because it was such high stress. Because they had the guy who wrote the book was originally going to be the screenwriter. And he's like, I kind of hit a wall. So that's when they brought in somebody else. And they also, you know, they wanted to make a little light and add some jokes. And obviously there's definitely some funny parts. So yeah, they were still working out a lot of kinks. It's so crazy though. Yeah. You hear all these stories and then you're like, how the hell did they,
that did this and this was that,
right? Not only like, pull it together, but make this classic. It took
78 days before it overtook The Godfather's highest grossing film in North America. So that's no small feat. The Godfather, another very iconic film, released at the same time. And so it's crazy.
Sadly though, the guy who wrote it, he did regret writing the book and then making the movie after he saw people straight up murdering sharks out of like fear after seeing Jaws.
Well, yeah, you can't ever picture that would be the outcome, right?
Again, so fictional shark. Fictional. Again,
this is movies, people, movies, but humans are just stupid. So something that's not stupid, the bigger boat line was actually improvised by the actor. I thought that was pretty cool. Like, hey, we're going to need a bigger boat. And they kept bringing it up.
And then we got Crush It Like Quint. For anybody who hasn't heard this, you see Quint drink the beer and he crushes his can. And then Hooper finishes his coffee and crushes his styrofoam cup. However, yeah. Narragansett, every year Shark Week, they do a Crush It Like Quint. And they do a whole campaign and all the merch and whatnot. And I need a Crush It Like Quint shirt. It's so cool.
I love it. I love Narragansett. I've had so many of those before Bruins games. It was awesome.
Oh, I have family in Rhode Island. I've had many a Narragansett.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So Steven Spielberg was actually not the first director choice, but the original director called the shark a whale, and the writer said he wanted a director that knew the difference. Like, what? How do you not know the difference?
Well, I think when he was saying, he's like, oh, and then the whale, and they're like, it's not a whale, and it's, I think,
he's like, yeah, yeah, whatever.
Their concern, though, was some people were thinking Moby Dick, which Moby Dick is a sperm whale.
Oh,
and
yeah,
obviously,
that's true.
A sperm whale and a great white are very different. I mean, a sperm whale is the more, you know, they actually have teeth and not baleen, but they're one's a mammal, one's a fish.
So, as we already mentioned, Spielberg was told to use a lake or a tank. He said no. And Jaws was actually supposed to come out the summer prior. However, the mechanical shark and the weather was not cooperating. And George Lucas actually got to visit the set. He playfully stuck his head in the shark's mouth. And at that moment, Milius and Spielberg grabbed the controls and clamped the jaws shut. That's amazing.
That is pretty funny. And then apparently they ran out of there because they thought they broke it.
It's like a bunch of kids, you know, we just get a bunch of grown adults / kids. They're just on set and having a good time. So the marching band on the 4th, John Williams didn't want to ask his professionals to not sound perfect. So Spielberg, who actually played clarinet in high school, jumped in to help them make them sound amateur. So that's a fun little thing. Brody's dogs are actually Steven Spielberg's. And then at the premiere, after the little boy was eaten, somebody got up and ran out and puked. And at that moment, Spielberg thought he had gone too far and he should have edited a little bit more.
Or maybe make amazing. It not I PG. Love,
right. Or again, this is a PG film. Like, you have little, it's crazy. And it's funny looking at this, right? At no point did you ever feel physically sick besides the fact that they're killing innocent sharks, but none of this was ever horror. So it's funny seeing the product of the times, like 1975, this is considered a horror film where people were scared and all this kind of stuff. Whereas now it's like almost a comedy action type film of sorts.
Yeah. Well, in that scene though, a kid dies. And I think that always like that, that's well, a, yeah, bold
you're seeing kid
choice
for 1975 standards. Absolutely. Yeah,
I mean, hell, PG even
film,
today,
for God's sakes,
there are certain things. It's like, you know, you don't kill the kid. It's nope, like I'm walking.
But Disney has no problem in their PG films killing parents.
Yeah, the parents got to go. That's how you build the character development, apparently.
Yeah.
So I actually randomly just, you know, have been watching Shark Fest all week, which is on Disney Plus, and they're obviously competing with Shark Week. And so I put on this documentary called Playing with Sharks, having no idea it had anything to do with Jaws. So it's about this older woman, Valerie, who she's still alive, but her husband has since passed and his name is Ron. And they were part of the shark people who got the actual shark footage of Jaws. And she describes the whole thing where the shark got stuck in the cage. So the guy who wrote Jaws looked, you know, we talked about him, Peter, he actually looked up to Valerie and Ron. And she was even asked if the book would make a good movie. And she said yes. And so did her. So did Ron. And again, though, she knew this was a fictional character, a fictional shark, not a real shark. Spielberg said he wanted to do the live shark stuff first. So they actually went out to Australia and did this before they did the stuff in Cape Cod. Valerie said they were not used to getting a shark to perform. Like she told them, like, you know, sharks don't perform. You can't just have them do this and then that's going to happen. So they were, you know, kind of chumming the water and whatnot. But in this documentary, again, it's called Playing with Sharks on Disney Plus, if anybody wants to watch it. So in the documentary, they do a frame for frame with the real footage and then stuff they, it's like you see the guy chumming the water and then you see Brody chumming the water. So it's a really cool to see these comparisons. And in it, they discuss how Steven wanted Bruce to be 25 feet long. And they told him that great whites are only, you know, usually about 13 feet, to which Steven said, well, then we'll use a little person and put him in a tinier cage so that this 13-foot shark will look like a 25-foot shark. They even had a fake half-size like scuba man that they used, and they had to use a smaller boat as well. So they had to get a littler boat.
That's cool. Wow.
They then had the actor who was someone who he'd been an actor before for stand-ins, or like he would play, like if it was a child on a horse, they would use him. I think he was like 4 foot something. But he had zero diving experience and was apparently allergic to like the sun and the salt water. And when he saw the shark, he said he should have asked for more money. And of course, he's supposed to be Hooper in the movie because you see Hooper in the scuba suit. So he went into the tank, and because they gave him, you know, when you're scuba diving, you have so much oxygen. The oxygen tank was smaller than normal because they needed everything to be proportional, which means he only had like 8 minutes of air. And oh, then wow. When he saw the shark, yeah. and the guy talking about it on the documentary too, he's like, you know, he may be a little person, but he still breathes the same amount of oxygen. And he took a deep breath when he saw the shark and then had to go up because he couldn't breathe. And so they brought him up. And fortunately, that was actually a good thing because they got him out. And of course, the cameraman is still down below filming everything, like on the bottom of the ocean. And then the shark, this is a real shark, not Bruce. That is when the shark bumped the cage and got stuck in the cage. And this is the footage you actually see in the movie. The guy was already on the boat. So Valerie grabbed another camera and filmed as well. And she got footage above, and the cage broke off of the boat. And they actually did that in the movie too. The cameraman in the water filmed the whole thing, and the shark actually swims below and he eventually gets out of the cage, which he was stuck in, and he eventually swam away, and they said it worked. Hooper was supposed to die, but because they got this footage of no one in the cage, that's why they ended up having Hooper be alive. And it was like he just swam away and hid while this was going on. So this was a happy accident that like this actual real live shark caused. Now, of course, the downfall of everything, which I said before, it really upset Valerie and Ron and many others who believed this movie and believed was real. People went out and killed sharks after this, and this upset them tremendously. Valerie even called Peter to discuss it. Universal actually had them tour the states and do interviews explaining that sharks are not dangerous. Sadly, the shark killing did continue, and they've said it's literally taken, you know, a generation, if not more, to convince people to go back into the ocean and be nice to sharks. And people would ask them in the interviews, well, you know, how can you say that after you, or why did you make this movie? And they're like, again, a fictional shark. This is fake. Sharks don't get up to 25 feet. It's like, you know, Megalodon came out and we didn't all go out killing sharks. So a large part of the shark population since this movie has come out in Florida has been completely destroyed. Valerie actually got the gray nurse shark protected, and this was the first shark ever to be considered protected. And it kind of blew my mind when I saw some of this, of like how many, like apparently, I mean, you can still find tiger sharks and hammerheads and great whites and everything in Florida.
Yeah.
But I guess it used to be much more dense. Of the, like, I mean, you could see, if you go down to the Keys, you're pretty much guaranteed to see a nurse shark. But I guess we used to have a lot more. I don't know. So there's a clip where a decent sized great white got its tail tangled. Wait, what did I already say that? Oh, so then she was trying to explain to people and doing videos showing that sharks are friends, not food. And there's actually a clip of Valerie and Ron in this documentary where a big great white got his tail tangled on like their line. They're able to get over to stand on some rocks, untangle him, and the great white lets them. And then once he's untangled, he very nicely just swims away. And 5 months later, he was killed by a fisherman. Years after filming this in Australia.
Hey, you snuck in that? That was depressing.
So the area that they filmed in Australia for Jaws, Valerie and Ron got that same area protected. So I thought that was really cool. Oh, and sharks can't swim backwards. You see Bruce do that. They can't, like, remember in the movie where the sharks were like super intelligent and all of a sudden they could swim backwards?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they're all cartilage. So like they can bend in half to get out of things. But so here are more animals that kill people than sharks every year. 1 million mosquitoes. Humans. 475,000 humans kill humans a year. Snakes, about 50,000. Dogs, about 25,000. Some weird fly, 10,000. Assassin bug, 10,000. Freshwater snail, 10,000. Roundworm, 2,500. Tapeworm, 2,000. Crocodile, 1,000. Hippo, 500. Elephant, 100. Lion, 100. Tapeworm's wolf, 10. Shark, 10.
Wow. I'm surprised, like, tapeworm's on there.
Yeah, that surprised me, too.
Should I be surprised? That's interesting.
But so
sharks don't kill people.
Yeah, sharks are friends.
Well, they do, but not
cows kill more people too. Cows weren't on the list, but when I googled them, it said cows kill about 22 people a year.
Hippos kill 500 people a year. That's pretty intense, considering they're above lions and wolves and sharks.
When we were like, in Africa, they straight up told us like the hippos are the ones you got to be concerned about.
Oh yeah, they are the one of the most deadly animals, and they're fast as can be. So that's weird.
My last. Two fun facts are all just pop culture stuff. Being that I do a lot of the theme park stuff in Florida, we did have the Jaws Rise in Florida. It closed in 2012 for Diagon Alley.
Diagon Alley.
The Bruce that was at the beginning of the ride, though, he is still there for a photo op near Diagon Alley in the San Francisco area. And you can still find some Amityville. Isn't that the horror movie? I did that a couple times, didn't
that
I?
That is the movie. It's Amity. It's not Amityville. Amityville is where you go to get... possessed and kill your family. Amity is the beach town.
I think I was saying Amityville this whole episode. So right now there is a gift shop at Universal. They change it out regularly. And right now it's all the legacy stuff. So it's a really cool, if you happen to go there, when you go in, it's near like Rip Ride Rocket and they have a whole ET thing, a whole Back to the Future thing and a whole Jaws thing. My last fun fact, Mallrats at the end, when they're with Jaws getting married, it is not Florida, even though they make you think it is. It is Hollywood. But the super fun fact is Brody and TS are named after Brody and Quint. So, and Brody is actually Brody Bruce after the shark, and TS's last name is Quint after Quint.
Interesting. Well, how does this movie hold up to you? Do you still enjoy it, or is it always kind of like a double edge for you? Because me, I still enjoy this film. It's more comedy to me. I appreciate the acting. I appreciate the technology that was used. And it's still one of the all-time greats to me. It's not in my top films ever made, but it holds up.
I think it holds up. I think it has funny moments. My only thing is the Hooper character drives me a little nuts because it's like he walks into Quint's lair and he sees all the shark jaws and he's like impressed. It's like, you're a marine biologist, right? Jackass. Like, why are you
impressed by this?
Yeah. He's like, wow, this is amazing. And then him telling the story of the shark that like ate his boat. Like, what the fuck? That doesn't make any sense. And that's how he fell in love with sharks after he watched a shark eat his boat and he had to swim to shore.
Yeah. That was weird. I think that would do the opposite, but Yeah, this movie's great. I enjoy it. I don't have any final thoughts. Any final thoughts before we wrap it up?
No, I keep forgetting to ask people for letters to the editor. I think that's all I have. Enjoy Shark Week. The Rock is hosting. Yeah.
Enjoy it. And fish your friends, not food.
And check out Discovery Plus 2 because they had some great documentaries last year. And that's it. Yeah, be nice to sharks. Don't kill sharks. Don't eat shark fin soup. Check your cosmetics and stuff for shark ingredients. I don't know.
We'll be back next week with another great episode. Make sure to follow us, Hops Geek News, on all of our social media accounts. That's where you can find our episodes, and also hopsnews.beer. Check out Lauren's great video content. She'll be getting some other things up there soon. And with that said, we will see you guys next week. Cheers, everybody.